Hi, I'm Dr. Paul with Chiropractic Personal Injury Marketing Show, and we're talking with Dr. Steve Wilson, chiropractic neurologist. And the reason we're talking with Dr. Wilson, he's kind of a special guest here for a series that we're doing, is Dr. Wilson is a chiropractic neurologist, number one. Number two, he's been a lecturer for three separate chiropractic colleges and postgraduate work. But more importantly, relative to what we're talking about, which is personal injury marketing, is Dr. Wilson does a lot of personal injury, but he's also been involved in several multi-million dollar personal injury cases. So he certainly knows quite a bit about his field. And so the topic we're talking about today is the dynamics of an injury or the mechanism of injury relative to that injury. And there's some, you know, when I talked with Dr. Wilson, there was some interesting takes on it. You know, there's the obvious. Some people, you know, you get in a car accident, you break a bone or whatever, you know. Those are the obvious brainers.
Sure.
But let's talk about just some of the mechanisms of injury for just a second of, you know, the angle of impact, the weather conditions, just briefly. But what was really important when I talked with Dr. Wilson that he gave me a lot of insight on was the soft tissues that frequently are overlooked and not accounted for and not documented. So we're going to go into that also. But let's run through the basics here. So let's, dynamics of injury. When you do your history, what are you getting?
In our history, the dynamics, the mechanism of the injury is important. We want to understand if it's a front impact, a lateral impact, a quartering impact, if it's from the rear, what type of, and we're talking about car wrecks in particular, but in those injuries, those dynamics have a part to play in whether or not certain types of injuries usually show up and the extent of those injuries. For example, a T-bone type of impact, a lateral impact, is very difficult to calculate relevant to the amount of force that's imparted into a person's body. We're flesh and bone, and the cars are steel and plastic and fiberglass and whatever, you know, all sorts of other parts that are made up. And we tend to want to equate, many of us, even physicians and legal personnel, attorneys out there that are analyzing, we tend to equate the extent of the crash of the vehicle as being the extent of the injury with the individual. But that's not really true. And the literature doesn't really support that. I've seen minimal impacts with people being killed. Very little, if any, noticeable damage to
that
car.
You know, that was just in the paper here together. There was somebody that was T-boned. Mm-hmm. The passenger died. The driver walked away.
Right. I mean, we can't estimate how that force is transmitted.
Right.
Having been present at crash testings where we've placed human occupants as well as crash test dummies, Series 7 dummies, which are the latest state-of-the-art, in vehicles and done minimal impact testing on these particular vehicles, we find totally different aspects of force transmission through a dummy versus a human. Mm. And we find that with two humans in the same car, the force is transmitted differently to both of them. It's impossible to calculate what happens in the milliseconds that it takes for force to be transmitted through a vehicle. So if it's maximal damage, even though we all tend to think, okay, there's a higher possibility that you may be severely injured in that accident, it doesn't necessarily play out that way. Mm-hmm. But it's important for us to obtain that history so that we have the best understanding as to what may have happened relevant to shearing forces, mm-hmm. relevant to what may have happened in the physics of that particular entity. And it tends to make us want to focus a little bit more on individuals. But it doesn't mean that we should forsake the individual that was in a minimal impact and say, oh, there's nothing wrong. We definitely want to x-ray that person if there's some subjective complaint. We're finding some objective findings. We certainly want to go further and analyze until we understand exactly what's happened to that individual, irregardless of the extent of the crash or the mechanism at play. You know, we tend to think, okay, there might be more force transmitted through the vehicle if the roads are wet or if it's icy or snowy outside.
Those are generalizations.
Yeah, they are. We tend to think, you know, there's more force that's imparted that way. But you can still have significant injury with minimal damage to a vehicle on a dry, sunny day where everybody slammed on the brakes and they barely touched each other.
Or the opposite of that is like the IndyCar drivers that major impact and
major
the driver
impact
walks
and they walk away, or you know, like Dale Earnhardt in the other hand.
Oh yeah,
not that much damage to his car, but it killed him.
Right,
you know, it was
right.
a terrible thing. These things happen. Those dynamics are really, really difficult to separate.
So I guess what we're talking about, you know, a lot of people take for granted, especially the chiropractor specifically, you know, the speed of the impact, whether the road was wet or raining or snow or, you know, some of those factors. Are there any in particular that you're kind of seeing routinely? I know one that I used to see is like if the patient head was turned, when, you know, like if they were looking in the rearview mirror on impact because the joints were already locked out, it seemed like that just created more problems for that patient.
Oh, certainly. You know, if you've got any angularity to spine in a transmission, we certainly see a lot more injury to mm-hmm. spine as a consequence. And certainly into the joints, the zygapophyseal joint structures mm-hmm. tend to become much more injured, a lot more inflamed. Mm-hmm. They certainly swell up a lot more. It's like jamming a finger, and it becomes a very painful entity.
You know,
and disc injuries are at a higher
when you're rotated.
Yeah. I see much more pathology.
A lot of the personal injury attorneys don't really understand the anatomy because they haven't been educated in physiology and anatomy and physiology.
Sure.
So this is real important when you're communicating and talking with the attorney relative to your patient. Some of these dynamics, how they relate to tissue damage.
Well, certainly, and I think it's important to understand that force transmission through a vehicle is very immediate. Within 300 milliseconds of impact from a rear end impact, the bumper's already been depressed down to the end of the shocks on the bumper. That shocks have transmitted the force into the frame into the seat bolts, into the seat, and already into the passengers and the driver. They've already received a substantial shock, and in 300 milliseconds, nobody can react to that. So there's no way to really guard mm-hmm. against this. So even if it's a minimal impact versus a very high speed impact, significant trauma can come about as a consequence mm-hmm. of those.
So in short, what we're saying, I guess what you're saying is you know, the dynamics of injury are important, but the bottom line is, you got to know them, but the bottom line is a good thorough evaluation of that patient.
Oh, I think
and documenting,
critical.
Kind of paying attention to the dynamics of injury, but don't get obsessed with, you know, that if this injury wasn't much, there's probably much here, or if there was a lot, there should be a lot here. Not necessarily a correlation.
Not really. It's not a good corollary. It's a bad habit to get into,
mm-hmm.
but we all may fall prey to that, oh, well, you know, it's not a real big deal. But it could be a very big deal. And you may have a patient that has some serious trauma,
mm-hmm.
broken neck, for example, as a consequence of minimal impact. Or you may have a patient that has very minimal damage as a consequence of a horrendous car crash. And they tend to walk away with, you know, nearly an acre of pain.
You know, most of the injuries that we see as chiropractors aren't the broken bones and, you know, severe, really severe. You know, most injuries aren't, when I say severe, I guess the perception of severe, major lacerations and things of that nature. But there's a lot of people that have injuries. You know, one of the things that Dr. Wilson has enlightened me upon is I was so used to looking at the ligaments and the joints and things of that nature, but as a chiropractic neurologist, boy, he really turned the switch on even if all that anatomy is good, the ligaments and the tendons and the disc and the cartilage, the soft tissue, meaning the nerves, the nervous system, and boy, you certainly made, you know, when you were talking about the brain and the how sensitive the brain tissues are.
Certainly, you know, brain and cerebellum and spinal cord,
mm-hmm.
your brain stem, descending pathways in the cord,
mm-hmm.
the peripheral nerves, those are all extremely soft, very friable tissues that are subjected to some high tensile strength damage as a consequence of a very mild impact whiplash type injury, a rear end impact, for example. I find a lot of damage to those types of tissues that's rather significant.
And that could be without torn ligaments and fractures and
things like that. Definitely.
Yeah.
You know, so those things can happen. Impingement syndromes in muscles
mm-hmm.
Can happen as a consequence of a mild trauma, but certainly nerve damage can
mm-hmm.
come about as well. We see a fair amount of mild traumatic brain injuries as a consequence of very intermittent losses of consciousness, and some individuals with no loss of consciousness.
And you know, most chiropractors, I got to be honest with you, the ones I've talked to, and I hate to say it, but I didn't do probably as good an evaluation as I should have of paying attention to the brain injury, the brain bruising, the loss of memories, and maybe a little bit of slurred speech or things of that nature. So can you help out the, what would you say to the chiropractor who's not paying as much attention as to the soft tissue, the nerves and the brain, and as opposed to the heart, you know, the ligaments and discs?
Well, relevant to neurological aspects of treatment, I'm a trained specialist in that arena. If you feel incompetent in that area, go get further training in that area. Go study neurology further. Join a neurology
program.
But
you know, it's one of those things, if you don't even know to look there,
you don't look.
You don't even look.
You're not going to look. You know, if you're just, I'm spine only. Well, guess what? You know, there are a lot of nerves coming out of the spine, as you all recall.
Yeah.
And as a consequence, you really want to assess what's happening to each and every one of those areas. And every cell in your body is going to fire pathways through nerve tissue that will ultimately wind up in brain, and as a consequence of that brain interaction, neurophysiological reflexes are set up. They're either lost as a consequence of damage, or they're maintained as a consequence of integrity. Mm-hmm. So we want to assess the integrity of that nervous system to the best that possible ability that we have, and be able to analyze any damage that may be affected as a consequence of this particular person's trauma. And I see this years after an accident, many years after a case is settled, for example, patients are still complaining of these subtle problems that are slowly propagating and becoming more dramatic for them, and there's no answer out there for most of the physicians that they see, whether it's medical or osteopathic or chiropractic.
Now, you're referring to the neurological component, right?
Absolutely.
Because the chiropractors are pretty good at, you know, the DJDs and the joints.
Oh, they're real good at joint pathology,
right.
And I think they're very good, but the cases that fall through their hands, they really may need to look more at a neurological component for that, and look at the neurophysiological aspects that particular lesion has created.
Right.
It may be brain-based, and we may miss that as a consequence of how we surmise the accident, the dynamics of the accident.
Let me ask you, for the chiropractor who's watching this that didn't take, you know, got the neurology in school but didn't take any additional courses, what could they do to help them beef up their sense of awareness to some of these, you know, the brain bruising and the neurology of these traumas that could help them help their patients and therefore help the attorneys? Do you have any suggestions for them?
Neurology residency. That's what I would suggest. It's an arduous program, but it was a specialty.
Well, then
that
we'll talk to you 3 years later when you're done with your neurology.
If you have questions relevant to a patient that is injured and you think or suspect some neurological component, go get a neurological consult and use your specialist.
And that's one of the things we talked about with Dr. Wilson is the other chiropractors that use him for a neurology consult, just because he's, he talks the language of chiropractic. So it's very easy for a chiropractor to refer him a patient for a neurology consult as opposed to the neurologist. So, but even the neurology courses, they don't necessarily even have to get their residency, but they could just go in there and pick the certain courses that would help them relative to trauma, couldn't they?
Oh, certainly.
In the curriculum,
go to any one of the courses, and I think that would help them understand a certain phase or area that they may be interested in. Any one of the courses.
It's so important. We're going to actually do a show just on that topic alone, but after talking with Dr. Wilson and practicing 16 years, I realized that I was not paying nowhere near the attention to, and again, when I say soft tissue, I'm referring to neurological brain, as opposed to, you know, the things that the typical chiropractor will look at as the disc or the joints or DJDs, things of that nature. So what would you say the percentage of patients are, would you see, that have some type of neurological component? Is there any way you could say that, you know, there's more neurological going on here than what you are seeing? Maybe you're just not looking for it.
I'm sure that's the case. So many of us are used to looking at range of motion, for example, doing a Kemp's procedure, doing a foramina compression test, a Spurlong's test, various other procedures that we may assess, and we tend to miss the subtleties of neurological, physiological damage, which may show up in something as simple as eye movement, yet that's a very complex area for assessment. And it is a difficult area to pick up unless you're well-trained in those areas. Most of my medical neurologists don't look at that very critically because it's also a difficult area, and they don't understand the physiological application of treatment, functional neurology, as it were, where the chiropractic neurologist is really a specialist in functional neurology, and we utilize physiotherapeutics for treatment applications. But some of them might be very simple treatment applications that we can give to our referring physicians and let them carry out those treatment applications so that they have a better outcome for their patients.
Let me ask you this. The chiropractor who sees those, you know, PI patients, but let's say, would you suggest that he at least get a basic flatline assessment, neurological assessment from his personal injury patients? Would you recommend something like that?
Any time there's any sustained pain or any sustained damage, or you think you may have some permanent damage, particularly of an orthopedic structure, like a disc, for example, if you think there's disc damage or it shows up on an MRI, there's a chance for frank radiculopathy, there's a chance for sensory radiculopathy, there's a chance for myelopathy. You may have ruled out some of those things. However, there may be other chances that there are more subtle types of brain lesions that might be going on, other things that could be affecting this particular patient that should be brought to the forefront.
And I guess
so
I'm referring
they can
to
get the
like,
best representation.
Like you were talking to me about earlier, like memory loss.
Sure.
Little bit of slurred speech or a little bit of a visual problem, but again, if you're not looking for it, you don't pick it up.
You know, the subtle problems that you might not be used to looking at might become bigger problems down the road if left untouched, if no one attempts to help them with those. Some of these things, and a lot of these things that I see, they're rather easy for us to change the physiological application for so that they function better and they have a better integrity. Even individuals that have rather catastrophically disrupted nervous systems can be helped a lot of times rather significantly.
And
so I certainly don't want to let it fester and let it get worse and have a greater demise down the road.
Yeah, and of course the whole objective here is to catch all this within your patient and obviously to help them the best as you can. But if you can, it's to be able to objectify, document, and report on it for that attorney and create value. So in saying that, would you say that the chiropractor probably shouldn't get a neurological consult until maybe there's some lingering going on? Is that what you're saying?
Well, if he sees or she sees any type of damage or irritation or other pathology that's persistent, that's non-responsive to treatment, certainly they warrant that.
Okay.
If the patient's complaining of things that doctor just doesn't understand or doesn't see or can't explain, certainly a neurological consult is warranted.
What if right off the bat you're doing the consultation and the patient's saying right off the bat things like blurred vision, memory loss, slurred speech, just a little...
Those are definitely clinical signs that you want to have looked at right away.
Okay.
Because you may have something else going on, such as a subdural hematoma, slow bleed type activation.
Right.
Other things could be coming on, an aneurysm that's aggravated or irritated.
But you can understand, if I'm the chiropractor that doesn't have neurology training, I'm listening for pain, numbness, tingling, and so if I'm not paying attention, and they say things like memory loss or splurge, and it's just minor, because a lot of times they won't shake you and go, "Doctor, I got memory loss." It won't happen that way.
No, it's not. It's going to be subtle, less subtle comment. Because these patients are often ashamed. They feel...
Well, they won't correlate it with you, the chiropractor.
No, and they might not associate you as the chiropractor, as the specialist for saying something like that. When we're all trained in it. You know, we all had neurophysiology. We all dissected brains. We all did, all of this neuroanatomy, and we all did all of our clinical studies based on neurology and based on orthopedics, based on aspects of the assessment and clinical treatment for various individuals that have traumas and those that don't. we based ourselves on functionality of individuals. Well, they might not be able to surmise that. So you do want to ask appropriate clinical questions so that we get that information from them right up front. And then if they do have any complaints that you can't address or that you have difficulty with or you want a second opinion on, feel definitely go get that opinion.
Yeah, and lastly, the importance of, relative to this patient's case, if you can and do document in the personal injury attorney any type of brain bruising, things like that, can you express the importance of that relative to that patient's case?
Oh, well, yeah, you want to be able to at least explain that from not only a clinical standpoint, but most importantly, a therapeutic standpoint. Is this something that's permanent? Is this something that can be repaired? Mm-hmm. Is this something where the patient may have a demise in the future? Could it get worse? These are questions you want to be able to answer. There's certainly medical legal implications that could be rather significant for a brain traumatized individual versus a small disc herniation in the neck with or without radiculopathy. Mm-hmm. These are different impairments. These are different psychologically impacting events that happen. So
yeah, yes. And again, like I said, when I spoke with Dr. Wilson, he really enlightened me, turned on a lot of my switches of, boy, I probably was missing some neurological components. The subtle ones, the obvious ones you won't miss, but the subtle ones. And those are important, and that's what that creates value for the patient, which in turn, if you can document that, not only try to help the patient, but give the report for the personal injury attorney, that creates value for them, okay? And that's all part of it, and that's what you're here about. So again, these are, in short, we're talking about the dynamics of the injury, no correlation necessarily between speed, impact, etc. What is important is to document the mechanism of injury, A, but B, keep that separate, document their injury. Be extensive and document their injury. That's really the end game when we're talking about dynamics of injury, okay? So again, this is Dr. Paul. If you have any questions, you can email me at drpaul@onlinechiropracticmarketingsystems.com, and we will see you on the next show. You take care.